inaugural last lecture brought to you by the... What's it called again? Fine Arts and Lecture Committee and Student Life. And so this is really inspired by Dr. Randy Pausch of Carnegie Mellon, and who gave, when he was dying of cancer, gave what was to be his last lecture. It became a powerful video and book. And so we're having the last lecture series. We certainly hope this will not be Dr. Barton's last lecture. Far from it. But the idea is to ask the professors at Dalton State to give lectures that would be their ultimate lecture. And so we have invited Dr. Barton to be the very first speaker. And I know you're going to enjoy this. Dr. Barton has published a number of academic articles. He has also published two books, one on reality television and one called The Big Damn Firefly and Serenity Trivia Book. And he is also, in collaboration with Dr. Jonathan Lampley, and they're together editing a new book on fan behaviors. And so he is prolific in his writing and presenting. He's presenting at national conferences all around the country. And he is a young man of remarkable gifts and talents. And we at Dalton State are delighted to have him as one of our colleagues. He is one of the many great faculty members that we have here. I can say that because I'm a faculty member here. And our Vice President for Academic Affairs, Dr. Sandra Schoen, would attest to the fabulousness of all of us. She is here. Nielsen, Mary Nielsen, Chris's Dean is here as well, and some of his colleagues. We will have two more of these this year in the spring semester, so make a note for the month of April, Dr. Christy Price, who is a professor in our psychology department here at Dalton State, will be speaking in the month of April. And in the month of March, I don't remember the name of the speaker, but I understand that he is dynamite, handsome, funny, vain, sophisticated, witty. I don't know, I think. Oh, it's me. In March. But tonight, we are very fortunate to have Dr. Kris Barton, Associate Professor of Communication Studies at Dalton State. Ladies and gentlemen, won't you welcome Dr. Kris Barton.
Thank you. It's nice to be closing for Jared's time. I told my students I wanted more people here than Buzz Bissinger had 2 weeks ago. And there are more people here than Buzz Bissinger had 2 weeks ago, so therefore, I am a more popular speaker than Friday Night Lights Off and Buzz Bissinger. I'd like that. Yes! Friends, family, colleagues, guests, students that were forced to be here, thank you for attending. I'm going to reiterate a little bit of what Jerry said. For those of you that might not be familiar with what the last lecture is, the original last lecture, like you said, was given by Carnegie Mellon Professor of Computer Science, Randy Pausch, on September 18, 2017. By that time, Pausch had been diagnosed with pancreatic cancer. And he'd been told by doctors he only had about 6 months of quality living ahead of him before his body started to deteriorate. Instead of focusing on his own mortality or the search for God or some of those type of issues, he decided to take a different approach to the legacy he wanted to leave behind. The actual title of Pausch's last lecture was Really Achieving Your Childhood Dreams, during which he spoke about all the wonderful opportunities he had in his life. He spoke in front of about 400 people at Carnegie Mellon, and that video of the last lecture has been viewed on YouTube over 15 million times since. As Jerry said, a book was published titled The Last Lecture, which was released about 7 months after the video went viral online. Randy Pausch died later that year on July 25th, 2008. But his legacy lives on through the uplifting message and the bravery with which he battled and faced his disease. I intentionally didn't watch the video until earlier, last week, because I didn't want to copy or imitate anything that he had done. Not that I could have if I tried. And in the spirit of that, I want to honor what he did with his last lecture, and I don't want to make this a somber event. So in that spirit, when Jamie Hall and the Fine Arts and Lecture Series Committee and the Office of Student Life asked me to present as part of this last lecture series. The first thoughts that went through my mind were the first thoughts that those of you would have in this situation. If this is my last lecture, what am I dying in? And I am sure that I could have come up with some creative or maybe humorous things that I might die of. But this is where I turned the portion of the lecture over to my students. I handed out earlier this semester this flyer, which originally said, you can help kill Dr. Barton, but there was some concern that should that get around, that might work better. And I asked them to submit their ideas on why they thought this might be my last lecture ever. And I told my students that if they gave me one of the best ones, if they submitted one of the best, I would put it in here. So here are the best suggestions for why I will die this semester. Justin Campbell from my intro to mass media class suggested that I would be killed while leaving Dalton Depot on Tuesday night following our weekly trivia game when one of the other participants and I get into an altercation over Andrew, which I am missing trivia right now to be here. Frankie Booker from my Mass Media and Society class thinks I would be impaled through the chest by Chief Osceola's flaming spear at the 50-yard line at a football game after receiving an award from Florida State University. You put Florida State in that thing and I'm calling the picture. Josh Beard, another intro student, thinks that I'll die while performing the Truffle Shuffle as part of a community student's class. If you don't know what the Truffle Shuffle is, I am not going to share it. But look it up. But the one that I think honestly has the most realistic shot of happening comes from Mass Media and Society student Frank Hilliker, who suggests that I will pass away from lesions that develop on my occipital lobe due to prolonged exposure to the Kardashians TV series. I don't watch it, but a little bit I think would go a long way. The funny thing is, this may not be that far from the truth. Like most people, I contemplated my time on this earth and when I'll be taken from it. And in looking back, I noticed a pattern. It seems my concerns about death stem from issues of the unknown, but not the unknown of what lies beyond this mortal coil and existential questions about the existence of God. What I've always been worried about is missing out on the media landmarks of our time. My concerns selfishly stem not from what happened in the next part of my journey, but from what I'll miss out on this one. In May 2002, shortly after seeing Star Wars Episode II, Attack of the Clones in the theaters, I worried that some tragedy might befall me before I would make it to see how the saga ended in May 2005. After successfully making it through, my next milestone was to make it to July 21st, 2007, so that I might find out how the Harry Potter series ended when the final book, The Deathly Hallows, was released. May 23rd, 2010, the final episode of Lost airs, when I finally learned all the answers to the island's secrets. I did not. That was followed by May 4th, 2012, when The Avengers premiered in theaters a few months ago. What I started to realize as I put this list together is that my life, in so many ways, has been shaped by the media. Television, books, films have all played a huge part in my life, as much today as when I was little. The irony here is, as a media scholar, I'm continuously warning my students about the dangers of the mass media. Some of the earliest media effects research conducted in the early years of the 20th century all decried the dangers of overexposure to mediated messages. Even the field of communication itself was born in the midst of World War II, when the United States government made it a priority to understand the effects of Nazi propaganda on American citizens, and how we might be able to launch a series of counteroffensive messages in turn. What emerged as a result of those early days of study into the field of communication were a number of theories that explain and predict how we use media today. The cultivation theory of communication states that television cultivates us to see the world around us as it's presented on television. For example, if you watch a lot of TV on a regular basis, over time, you're going to begin to think the world is a more violent place because that's what you see on TV all the time. Every show, to some degree, involves conflict. And it's not that you're deliberately learning from TV, but over time, all that exposure begins to have an effect whether you realize it or not. For example, a lot of my early research explored the cultivation effects of reality TV. And what I found was that people who watch more competition reality TV shows like Survivor or Big Brother are more likely to think that people will lie to them or that people are going to try to backstab them to get ahead in life. They see these behaviors more often than people who never watch reality TV. So it makes sense that to some small degree, that would seep into how they perceive the world around them. Basically, decades of cultivation research has shown us that the world, as depicted on television, is completely different from the real world. And it really does change what we think is real and what we know about the world around us. The ultimate example, there have been a number of studies on soap operas. And if you compare people who watch soap operas to people who don't watch soap operas, the people who watch soap operas are, to a small degree, more likely to think that in the real world, there are people with evil twin brothers who are trying to steal babies, as compared to people who don't watch soap operas. And they don't consciously realize that they've been affected by TV, but to a small degree they have. We all. I've also recently completed a study that will appear in an upcoming volume of Communication Quarterly, a journal that explores how people use media. In it, I used the uses and gratifications theory to look at why people say they watch talent-based reality TV shows like American Idol or Dancing with the Stars. The number one finding that emerged from the study was that people watch these shows because they like to see people perform badly. They love watching people make fools of themselves in front of judges on American Idol, for example. Most of you in this room have probably seen William Hung sing his version of She Bangs, or General Larry Platt's original song, Pants on the Ground. The reason that these became internet sensations was because we used TV as a way to laugh at. I hate to say it, but to a degree, that's what the television industry gives us, because that's what we want to see. I don't want to turn this into a lecture that I would give in my class, because at that point, I would just be giving the note away for free. But there are a few seminal works in this area that specifically speak to the inherent dangers of the mass media. And I'm going to primarily focus on television and film, although we could certainly extrapolate and explore other media as well. At the extreme end is Gerrymanders, and that's his real name, 1977 work, Four Arguments for the Elimination of Television. As the title suggests, Mander puts forth four arguments, well-reasoned and researched, that make the case for completely eliminating television from our society. He claims that television has negative effects on humans in every measurable way, cognitively, emotionally, culturally, and even physically. Specifically for me, Mander's fourth argument makes a particularly salient point given the direction of today's media. In it, Mander states that television is inherently biased in what it shows. He notes that as a visual medium, TV is predisposed to almost exclusively show negative emotions, negative behaviors, and negative actions. Negative emotions are so much easier to show on TV because that's what the medium almost doesn't have a choice but to show those types of things. It was designed that way. Physical violence is the ideal content for an audiovisual medium. Even emotions like anger, jealousy, and hatred are played out beautifully through the explicit language and facial expressions shown. By contrast, I want you to try to think of how you might portray more positive emotions on television, like contentment or serenity. Or intimacy. And when I say intimacy, don't mistake that for meaning sex. What I mean are those small, quiet moments between you and someone you love, where you're just happy to be sitting next to each other on the couch. A comfortable silence as you both enjoy a ride in the car. In real life, these are the moments that give us joy and fill our lives with meaning. On TV, they're known as the most boring show ever. Another argument that Mander makes in his book is that television is harmful to us because it causes us to become lazy in our critical thinking skills and impairs our ability to reason. This perspective is also advocated by Neil Postman in his 1984 book, Amusing Ourselves to Death. In it, Postman takes a slightly different stance on television. He sees nothing wrong with television as a means of entertainment, but rather has concerns about when we try to use the medium for serious endeavors. In fact, he says in the book, "I raise no objection to television's junk. The best things on television are junk. It's when we try to learn from television that the danger becomes very real." So what Postman's basically saying is that he's fine with the Jersey Shore. He's fine with Honey Boo Boo. Because no one in their right mind is trying to learn from those shows. The much more dangerous shows are the ones that try to educate us in some way, like Meet the Press or The Nightly News. As the saying goes, the road to hell is paved with good intentions. And while these shows have good intentions, the results are ultimately not what they are intended to be. Political elections have been reduced to 30-second ads that tout simple solutions to some of our country's most serious problems and feature candidates that must look like a politician. Religion has been taken out of our churches and temples and beamed into our homes, replacing the sanctity of a house of worship with a lazy boy and some Pop-Tarts. Well, we'll Education has been replaced with edutainment, with many shows masquerading as educational while really only serving to hypnotize children and dazzle them with bright colors and characters that can be easily transferred onto lunchboxes. I should mention here that media's negative impact on education doesn't stop with young children. Too often, public school teachers and even some college professors, and I don't need to attack anyone in here that this might apply to, show films that are meant to illustrate a particular aspect of history or society. 2 weeks ago, when Friday Night Lights author Buzz Bissinger, my close personal friend, spoke to my mass media student, he admitted that the claim based on a true story or inspired by real events is misleading, and that they should be renamed based on a story that at one point was true. For example, during my senior year in high school, my AP history teacher offered us extra credit if we went and saw the film Braveheart, claiming it would paint a picture of 13th century Scotland and make us appreciate what William Wallace did for his country. And after watching the film, I thought I knew history. After all, my teacher at the time had endorsed it. Unfortunately, Hollywood's goal isn't to educate, it's to put butts in the seats. If you do even a minimal amount of research on what really happened, it doesn't take very long to figure out that most of what I've learned about William Wallace wasn't even close to the truth. Ignoring the inaccuracies in the battles and who was actually involved and the fictionalized portrayal of Wallace's life, let's look at one relatively minor story point that illustrates what I'm getting at. In the film, for those of you that haven't seen it in a while, William Wallace is shown having an affair with Princess Isabel, the wife of Edward II, and the daughter-in-law to Wallace's nemesis in the film, Edward I. As the film closes, Isabel reveals to the elder Edward that she is carrying, that the baby she is carrying is not his son's, but Wallace's, effectively ending his lineage and tormenting the frail king as he succumbs to old age. Good move, okay? Unfortunately, there are a number of problems that arise when the facts presented in the film are compared to what really happened. History puts Princess Isabel's actual age at somewhere around 5 years old at the time of Wallace's execution. She also happens to be living in France at the time and was nowhere near Scotland when the film takes place. As for the son she claims to have conceived in Wallace in the film, who would become Edward III, he was born 7 years after Wallace was killed. So if a student thinks they're learning about history from Hollywood and these films based on true stories, they are gravely mistaken. So to my colleagues here tonight, I implore you to please not show these films because in actuality, they are doing more harm than they are good. But does this suggest that we can't learn anything from television or films? I don't think so. For all the negative aspects of electronic media and for all of its faults, I have to believe that media all have their redeeming qualities. As Nietzsche said, whatever is done from love always occurs beyond good and evil. And think about how many times in your life you've said you love a movie, or a TV show, or a musician. Mass media have brought us all so much joy in our lives, it would be hard not to fall in love with what we see, hear, or read. Which brings up a particular pet peeve of mine I've had for a number of years now. If someone ever asks you what your favorite movie is, and you can give them an answer, you can pick one movie that's your favorite, that means you haven't seen enough movies. There are way too many fantastic movies in this world for you to be able to pick one. You should be speechless. Jerry Seinfeld, when he recorded one of his comedy albums live on Broadway, he invited the audience at the end of the set to throw questions up and ask him questions. And one of the audience members shouted out, "What's your favorite episode of Seinfeld?" And Jerry Seinfeld paused for me and he said, "That's like asking me what my favorite breath I've ever taken is. I need them all. How can you pick one when all of them make up who you are?" So I can't fathom the notion that something so powerful, so compelling, and such an important part of my life has no redeeming value, despite everything that I've just mentioned. The mass media have been instrumental in most of the major life decisions I've made. If it weren't for TV and movies, I may not have ever met my wife, who's here tonight in the fourth row. When she said that she loved reality TV and she quoted lines from Talladega Nights, I knew I was in love. If it weren't for reality TV, I wouldn't be standing here speaking to you tonight. I became completely enthralled with the new genre of TV called reality TV after watching the first episode of Survivor when it premiered in the summer of 2000. Because of that, I went on to get my master's in communication as well as my PhD. And my dissertation was eventually published as my first book available in the bookstore, which is all about the effects of reality TV and how what they are on us. And in general, the effects are not good. And in thinking about it, despite all that stuff about you can't learn history from movies, I know that the media have taught me things. There have been things that I've taken away from them, and things I've kept with me for decades that have helped me, not just in school, but in my life. In middle school, I remember watching reruns of The Facts of Life and seeing an episode where Natalie was having trouble in science. She just could not remember the symbols on the periodic table. That's when Tootie gives her a mnemonic device that's stuck with me ever since. She suggested that Natalie imagine someone had just robbed her. And in that situation, her first reaction would be to yell, "Hey, you, come back with my gold watch." AU being the symbol for gold on the periodic table. That works, by the way. And that's how I learned about virtually every subject in middle school and high school and beyond. At some point, they were all bound to be brought up in some form of media that I loved. I learned vocabulary from reading comic books. When Thanos united the six Infinity Gems to form the Infinity Gauntlet, he became, as I read it, omnipotent. I was later corrected by a new English teacher who informed me that it was pronounced omnipotent. I learned about government and politics from watching The West Wing. Prior to that show, I had no idea what a chief of staff was or what POTUS stood for. One of my favorite movie quotes of all time that's inspired me to delve into philosophy is, "Don't take life too seriously, you'll never get out alive." This quote reflects beliefs and teaching of philosophers as varied as Epicurus, St. Thomas Aquinas, and Soren Kierkegaard, and sparked a genuine interest in me to learn more about life and how I want to live it. And the film that contained this quote and has inspired me so, National Lampoon's Van Wilder. Take it where you find it. Because of films like Fargo and Borat, I've learned geography, and I can find places on a map I've never heard of before. Kazakhstan? That's not a real place. No, it's a real place. I gained a much deeper appreciation and understanding of history, especially for Abraham Lincoln's role in saving our country, from interesting and well-written books like Sarah Vowell's Assassination Vacation and James Swanson's Manhunt. I learned about physics from watching Warner Brothers cartoons, and that if you ever run off the edge of a cliff, you'll only fall if you look down. I gotta be honest, I don't know anything about science, so that one may not be right. But the rest of them, I'm pretty confident. But more than just learning about the world around us, media help us deal with events in our lives in ways few other things can. I would bet that a good number of the students in this room tonight have drowned their sorrows over a breakup with a pint of Häagen-Dazs and a night on the couch watching Love Actually. For those who have lost loved ones, books like Heaven is for Real and Tuesdays with Morrie offer us hope for the future and an outlet for our grief. For the players of Florida State's football team, they deal with the anxiousness of a big game by having the Phil Collins song In the Air Tonight played over the stadium loudspeakers to get them pumped up before a game. I could go into hundreds of examples of how media have been used to help people deal with traumas in their lives, including the incredible work done by organizations like the Make-A-Wish Foundation, which grants wishes for chronic and terminally ill children. While some kids wish to be police officers and ballerinas, there are pages and pages on the foundation's website that are dedicated to the celebrities and entertainers who have donated their time to fulfill wishes. One particular example that was recently granted was for Zachary, a six-year-old with leukemia who, during his lengthy stay in hospitals, watched the movie Hellboy, literally, according to him, 100 times. When the Make-A-Wish asked him what they could do for him, he said he'd like to meet Hellboy. So the Make-A-Wish people contacted the Academy Award-nominated special effects company, Spectromotion, who were responsible for creating the effects in Hellboy, and they in turn contacted actor Ron Perlman, the actor who portrayed the character in the 2004 film and its 2008 sequel. Without hesitating, Perlman agreed to undergo the 4-hour makeup process that would turn him into Zachary's favorite hero because a little boy asked. Knowing the enormous impact this would have, Spectrum Motion went on to even further, creating a prosthetic appliance for Zachary as well. One slide on. Ultimately transforming him into his own version of the character. I have little doubt that this will be something Zachary carries with him for the rest of his life. And as the Make-A-Wish Foundation's website says, these experiences provide the opportunity to replace anguish with smiles and laughter, even if just for a little while. And although Zachary's story had a happy ending, not all of them did. I joked earlier about how I was worried about not living long enough to finish the Harry Potter series. But for some people, that was a much more real concern. This is Katie Hope. In 1997, at age 6, Katie was diagnosed with a cancerous kidney tumor. Within a year, it evolved into neuroblastoma, an aggressive childhood cancer that would eventually attack her spine, lungs, and liver. Confined to a hospital bed, Katie's mother began reading her the Harry Potter series, but she slowly began to regret that decision. As she approached the end of the third book, she knew her daughter wouldn't live long enough to read book four. With her daughter having only months to live, Katie's mother wrote to the book's publisher, Scholastic Press, telling them about Katie's condition and asking when the fourth book would be available. Rather than the standard letter of response, standard form letter response, Katie and her parents were shocked when a few weeks later, a letter arrived from Harry Potter author J.K. Rowling herself. It read in part, "Dear Katie, I'm working very hard on book four, on a bit that involves some new creatures Hagrid has brought along for the care of magical creatures classes. You are an extremely brave person and a true Gryffindor. With lots of love, J.K. Rowling. Joe, to anybody in Gryffindor." Over the next few weeks, Rowling kept in contact with Katie and her family through letters and phone calls, and slowly divulged elements from the book from book four that were at that point some of the most highly guarded secrets in the world. 9-year-old Katie Hope was the first person outside of Rowling's inner circle to learn of events that would take place in the Goblet Fire. Their friendship was short-lived, however. As Katie's condition deteriorated, she became unable to use a computer. Understanding the time was short, Rowling set up a phone call to Katie, with her family gathered around a speakerphone in their living room, and Katie laid out on the couch. Rowling read her portions of the book that Katie's mother had feared she would never live to know. As her mother said later in an interview, Katie's face lit up as Rowling regaled her with Harry, Ron, and Hermione's adventures. From across an ocean, an author brought peace and happiness to a young girl whose time left on this earth was very short. Katie died days later, on May 8th, before her death, a family friend asked Katie, if given the chance, what she would change about her life. Katie's response was shocking. "I wouldn't change a thing." "Not even her illness?" "No, I wouldn't change that," Katie replied. "I've made new friends." By all accounts, Katie passed peacefully. Rather than resent her fate, Katie saw what many of us take for granted on a daily basis. The love of family, the company of friends, and the joy that a simple story can bring into our lives. For her part, Rowling was so moved by Katie that she established the Katie Hope Foundation, which is dedicated to helping children who are in treatment for cancer. Can anything that brings this much happiness into the world be as bad as some media scholars think? I very much doubt it. Like everything in life, too much of something is never good for you. But every single one of you in this room tonight have had the mass media play important roles in your life. You probably just didn't realize it. When I was asked to do this lecture, I started thinking about how much TV and films and books and music have influenced and shaped who I am. I was kind of surprised when I started going through old pictures and mementos to see how much of my life has been centered around my love for media. So what I put together are some media-related highlights of my life, and there's going to maybe be music we're going to see. Although not included here is when I met Davy Jones at the Monkees when I was 7, because my parents did not think to take a camera. But we'll see how this goes.
We walked on the beach beside the hotel.
Pictures, do you have a beaver haircut? Are there shots of you wearing a shirt with your favorite TV show character on it? I'd be willing to bet you've dressed up as a movie character at least once for Halloween. It seems like these types of speeches always end with the speech, with the speaker offering up some advice or words of wisdom. But since this lecture was on mass media, I think I'll share some of my favorite pieces of advice I've learned from them. So here are some of the things that I've learned about life and how I want to live it from the mass media. Talent is luck. The important thing in life is courage. Isaac, played by Woody Allen, in the movie Manhattan. Love is that condition in which the happiness of another person is essential to your own. Robert A. Heinlein, his book Stranger in the Stranger. That's not why. Which reminds me of another thing that I've learned from movies that I love, which is in all my favorite films, the nerd ends up with a beautiful girl at the end. If you can't do something smart, do something right. Jane Cobb, played by Adam Baldwin in the film Serenity. Every new beginning comes from some other beginning's end. The band Semisonic in their song Closing Time. Worrying is like a rocking chair. It gives you something to do, but it doesn't get you anywhere. Van Wilde, played by Ryan Reynolds in National Lampoon's Van Wilde.
Live every day like it's Shark Week.
Tracy Jordan, played by Tracy Morgan, on 30. So hopefully you've all learned something tonight. Yes, the media have their dangers, and we should be careful about using them. We shouldn't overexpose ourselves, or especially children. But in the end, what they give us is so much more powerful than what they take away. So to put a bow on this thing, and with all due respect to my students who offered up suggestions, I think I actually do know how I'm going to die and why this is my last lecture. Jamie Hall is going to kill me. Thank you all for coming.